This is a great problem because it's going to tie together a lot of concepts in this whole chapter. We're looking at a table that represents probabilities of having X number of Mexican-American jurors out of 12. So we can right away see the most common, the highest probability outcomes are 10 and 11. Together, that's almost 60%. We really should have that happen the most. And really 8 to 12, I would say, we're going to have over 95% of the time. If you look at the remaining probabilities here, those won't add up to 5%. And that's kind of a good general rule, is if you can find where 95% of data are found, that's what you expect 19 out of 20 times. That's 95%. Now, looking at the problem, in this specific jury, they must have had a 6 out of the 12. So they had 50% of that jury. And already we'd say that's pretty low. If we really should be at 86% on average. Now we do expect to see variation from that because of sampling. You get variation in sampling. But would we expect to get variation as much as we have from 50%, from 86% down to 50%? So the way we do that is we examine probabilities. Landing right on 6 is a pretty low probability. That's the 0.0028 or 0.28%. That's really unlikely. But then what we like to do is say, well, what if you were even more extreme than that? So if we pool all of these together, does that accumulate any kind of high probability? Because that would be a big target to hit anywhere from 0 to 6, and we would actually be on the higher end of that. So when we pool all those together, we just add the probabilities. In this case, the rest of these round to 0, so they're not going to amount to much. It might amount to 0.0001, but let me get to that in just a second. I'm just going to add these two together, and I'm going to actually get 0.0032 or 0.32%. Now, for this problem, that's how you're going to get the correct answer. But in actuality, when we have all these rounding to 0, that could accumulate to 1/10,000th or 1 in that last decimal spot. And this could actually be a misrepresentation. So sometimes what we'll actually do is calculate the total on the opposite side of the 6 in this case, and then subtract it from 1 or take the complement. So if this added up to 99.68% or 0.9968, then all the rest of it above should add up to the 0.0032. But on this problem, we're not going to get that in depth with it. This should be close enough. So this, what we're saying is the outcome that we got is only going to happen under 1% of the time. That really gives us, it gives us a little bit of evidence at the very least that there's some kind of discrimination or something going on. We can't conclude with certainty, but it does, we would say, suggest or provide evidence. Now, I want to dive a little bit deeper into this problem and talk about the concepts of mean, standard deviation, expected value, and even binomial probability distribution. So this will tie together the next few problems in the homework as well. What I'm going to do is go to Stapplet.com. You can also do this with Google Sheets, and I have some additional videos in the notes that go over that. And in Stapplet.com, go to Discrete Random Variables. This is a very easy to use applet. It doesn't have a whole lot of options like Google Sheets. You have a lot more you can do with it, but it's so much easier to use. What I usually try to do is describe the variable name, and then we'll enter each value, and for the 0 plus, we'll just put a 0. You could leave those off, but I like to be able to visualize the whole graph all the way down to 0. So I'll start by adding some rows. I'm going to need 13 rows to get all of this in. And then the easiest way to do it is you can use tab on your keyboard to go to the next cell over, and then tab, tab to get back to the next row. Now I filled in all of my X's and probabilities, and I'm down at the last one, and I'm actually going to leave it at 0 To show you what happens if the probabilities don't add up to 1, in Stapplet, you get an error. And it won't give you the error if you're pretty close to 1, but I'm far enough away, 16% away, that it's not going to allow that. So now I'm going to actually put in the value, begin analysis, and show you what we get. We get this nice graph to visualize that right away. We get to hover over those and see those probabilities. Unfortunately, it won't allow us to pool these. If we are able to identify that this is actually a binomial random variable, that applet has a little bit more that we can do. But for now, we're just using a table that we're given, and so we can't use more advanced features. But if we do need to pool these probabilities, just grab a calculator and add them together. And that's the kind of thing that we have to do, you know, on this problem here, is pooling those together. But the other things that we get from Stapplet is the mean and standard deviation. The mean is also called the expected value. Now, we don't expect to get 10.3 jurors who are Mexican American on this jury because it has to be a whole number. But that just gives us an idea of kind of the center of the target, kind of thinking about it in terms of like a dartboard. This is the middle of what we expect to get, and it's really on the high end of X. So because it's a high percentage, it's 86%, we really expect to be close to that value of 10 or 11. What we would use the standard deviation for is to determine kind of a range of values of what we would usually expect from this data set. We're going to have some deviation from that mean because of sampling. So we are going to see samples with only 8 or 7 jurors who are Mexican American. We're going to see those happen. This one's 5.69% of the time. This one's 1.48% of the time. The question is, you know, where do we draw the line for what starts to seem like it's really just way out of the ordinary? And what we usually do is go 2 standard deviations above and below the mean. So if I take 10.3 plus 2.4, which is about double the standard deviation, that's 10.3 plus 2.4, that'd be 12.7. So way down here, 12.7. Now that makes perfect sense because this is skewed. We're kind of right up against the edge, on the outside edge of it. So we're going to expect to see 12, 11, 10, 9, and then on the lower end, 10.3 minus 2.4 takes me down to 7.9. So 7.9 is right on the left side of that 8. So that gives us our usual range, 8 to 12. We're going to be outside of that range around 5% of the time, even a little less than 5% of the time. And in this problem, it was actually, the result was actually 6. And so that is outside of the usual range. That would give us some evidence that this sample was tampered with in some way. It wasn't simple random sampling, where we would expect to be more in that reasonable range from 8 to 12. Now I'm going to recreate this entire table and graph looking at it as a binomial distribution. Anytime we meet the requirements of binomial distributions, we can use this applet, and all we need is N and P. The requirements for binomial distributions, we need to have independent sampling from a large population, or independent by sampling with replacement. We need to have a fixed probability. We need to have this random number of successes, and we have all those things here. We have 12, we have a fixed number of draws, which is 12, that's our M, and then we have a fixed percentage. We're just presuming that that population is really big, so taking 12 people is not going to change this number. Like if we took 12 people from a population of 20, that percentage starts to change. Here we're saying, no, it's a big population, so we can look at it that way. And what I should see is a very similar, if not identical, graph. Comes down to the rounding a little bit, but you'll see those same numbers, 1637, 3197, 2863, and those are those same numbers that we saw in that table. So that's how it was generated. So all those rounded to 0 with 4 decimal places. If we wanted more precision, we should use Google Sheets, and we can have a lot more digits of accuracy. I have other videos showing how to use both Desmos and Google Sheets to do binomial distributions, but this one's definitely the quickest. And we have our mean and standard deviation there that are very similar to the numbers that we got from using the discrete random variable applet. The other great feature for binomial distributions is down here at the bottom. You can do pooling using this terminology, less than, at most, at least, more than. You can go in between two numbers for values of x. So for example, on this problem, I had to do at most 6 successes. In this case, successes is just whatever we define x to be. That was the number of jurors who are Mexican American. So that was 0.0033. Like I said, the rounding can cause that to be wrong. This should be a little bit more accurate. And then if we look from 8 to 12, for example, which is what I said is kind of the usual band where we would expect to be, that's 98% of the time.